Don't know why I love you. Don't know why I care. I just want your love to share. I wonder why I love you like I do. Is it because I think you love me too? I wonder why I love you like I do. Like I do.
It's summertime, summertime, some, summertime, 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 some, summertime, 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 some, summertime,
summertime, summertime, some, summertime, summertime.
Well, are you coming or are you waiting just for pop summer on the plane? Hurry up before I say it's summertime. Well, I'm so happy that I slip, oh, how I'd love to take a trip. I'm sorry, teacher, but take a trip because it's
summertime, summertime, some, summertime, 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 some, summertime, 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 some, summertime,
summertime, summertime, some, summertime, summertime.
It's summertime.
What's your stay at Tiger Town? Your performance has been watched with interest by Tiger Club officials and minor league managers. If you are assigned to one of the Tigers minor league clubs, you know that your performance will be checked frequently and closely, and that players who come on fast are moved up fast.
I spent a number of years living in Tiger area, and I just fell in love with the Tigers and have followed them ever since. I was out of the country when they finally won the World Series, but they did win it again after I got back. One of my early memories of baseball was breaking my nose playing baseball. I was a pitcher. I got to be pretty, not a bad pitcher. I was bigger than most kids, and we moved a lot when I was young, and so often we didn't have too many friends. So my brother and I would play catch out in the side yard, and I was always a pitcher, and he was a catcher. And I got to have a pretty steaming fastball. And I got into high school, and my eyes, when I was young, and this got gradually worse, and my lenses got thicker and thicker. And so you got to picture this. I'm a junior in high school. They send me out to pitch against a team who's from Lions Falls. I'm living way up in northern New York, a little town called Glenfield. First game of the season. And the catcher is a guy named Chick Baxter. Went there like crazy. So we start the game. So he gives me the signals, and I pitch the ball. And he kind of looks at me and he throws it back. And he gives me another signal and I pitch the ball and he throws it back. After about three or four, he walks out to the mound. And the coach is wondering what's going on. And Chick gets out there and he says, "You can't see the fingers." "No." He says, you're friggin' blind, aren't you?" I said, I guess, Chick. So by this time, the coach is walking out. He's wondering what's going on, and he comes out, and he says, "What's up?" And Chick says, "He can't see the fingers. He's friggin' blind." So the coach looks at me and says, "You can't see his fingers?" I said, "No." "Oh, you're friggin' blind, aren't you?" So by this time, the umpire is out there, and the coach turns to the umpire and says, "He can't see the fingers. He's friggin' blind." So the umpire goes back walking, and he dusts it off the plate, and he says to the batter, "He can't see. He's friggin' blind out there." Now pitching for Glenfield is Ray Charles. And the word soon passed from that batsman, that batter, down to the other guys on the team. And you know, they're a little worried. You remember Ryan Dern? He used to pitch for they used to wheel him out there and point him toward the plate and say, "He's just throwing that little vicinity." So these guys were intimidated before they came up to the plate. So it made my job a lot easier until they discovered that they could bunt. Because I was big and I was slow, but also I couldn't see out of the bottom of my lenses very well, so I'd go to scoop up the bunt, and I would often miss field. So they got onto me, and they compensated for the fact that I couldn't see them, but they could. I couldn't see the bun either. So. Shift to basketball. I just got a series of anecdotes. I played a lot of basketball. I was never much of a shooter, and I found out later it was because my eyesight was bad. It's odd to go back and play basketball at 50 and be able to make a heck of a high percentage of the shots that I couldn't make when I was in high school. But I was playing Tom Team basketball when I was about 30 years old. And we went to Cooperstown, which is not far from where I live now. And we're playing in the Cooperstown gym, which is now actually part of the Hall of Fame. They expanded into that gym. And I was driving toward the basket, and way up in the air, at least I think I was way up in the air, when you're 30, way up in the air is not what I thought when I was 19. And there were, I was going between two guys, one of them was a doctor, it turned out. And they pinioned me and upended me. And I ended up heading down toward the court, my feet up in the air. Remember in high school they taught you tumbling? You tuck your head and you roll. Yep. That's where they did this. And I have visualized that many times since, but I was not able to visualize that then. And instead of tumbling, what I did was a nice high dive into the floor. And I put my hands out and did just exactly what the tumbling coach had always told us not to do. And so I broke this wrist, and I dislocated this elbow very, very badly. And so they hauled me up to the Cooperstown Hospital. And I remember them, you know, they knew this wrist was bad, so they put a splint on that, and they x-rayed it. And they could see my elbow was in terrible shape, so they did the same over there. And I remember, did not anything else hurt any fingers, and they flexed my fingers, and they flexed my other wrist. No, I think I'm okay. So I had a very unsettled night and woke up in the morning, and they came in and checked me again, and this wrist hurt. And it turned out that this left wrist was smashed in exactly the way the right wrist was, but it didn't hurt the night before. It was as if the mind said, we've got enough to take care of here. And you know, you've heard of people who had injuries and they didn't feel them. So there I was with a broken wrist, and I remember the doctor flexing it up and down. I didn't feel a thing. The pain was so concentrated in the other parts of my body. Anyway, they had me all, you know, finally all bundled up. And I remember the doctor came along. There was a Dr. Dilly, his name was, and he was a great character. And he had an intern with him. And he had the intern putting the wrapping on to make the cast. It's wet tape that they put on that pardon. And Dilly was joking left and right, and he said to this guy, leave his fingers free, because they're wrapping up both arms. He says, leave his fingers free so he can. And so the guy kept wrapping. Then he said, leave his fingers free so he can. And the guy wrapped a little bit more. Then he said, leave his... He said, what do you mean, so he can? He said, so he can wipe his backside. But it was a terrible, painful experience. John Elway. We got to see John Elway play baseball. John Elway, when he was about to go into his senior year at UCLA, was allowed, NCAA rules allow, somebody to play one professional sport while retaining athletic status in another. So before he went back to his senior year to play for USC or UCLA?
Stanford.
It was in Stanford.
Stanford.
He was allowed to play baseball for George Steinbrenner, and played in Oneonta. I don't know how much George paid him, but I think it was pretty good luck. And it was very interesting to watch him play. He reminded me of Mickey Mantle because his swing was so smooth. And he I don't know if you would have seen him out here, probably. He just had such perfect coordination, and he picked up that ball so quickly that it wasn't a matter of whether he was going to hit the ball, it was a matter of where he was going to hit the ball. And he reminded me of Mantle because Mantle had that same ability. He would just run with the ball. Elway, if you had never seen Elway and you had no idea who was coming up to bat, and you've been watching the game, you'd know that this was a superstar, that he had a athletic ability that was above and beyond anybody else on the field. Mm-hmm. His reflexes were faster. His everything about him. That he was a superior athlete, just a superior physical specimen. And it was a joy to watch him, just for that reason alone, because you sat at some of these minor league baseball games and watched guy after guy after guy go up, and they all look the same.
Yep.
Very similar, very similar. And then this one guy out of a million steps up, and you know, this is...
Did Oneonta know, did Sam know that he had something really special?
Yeah, they did, because of course he was famous as a football player already. Yeah. Steinbrenner was trying to get him to play baseball instead of football. I'm sure he would have done very, very well in baseball.
He turned out a big bonus, didn't he?
I'm sure he did, yeah.
I think I remember that.
No, he played right field. Played right field. Jesse Owens. When I was in New Zealand, worked in advertising and public relations, and we had as a client, well, it didn't matter who, but it got involved in the Crippled Children Foundation that was run by Murray Hallberg. And Murray Hallberg was a world record holder for distance running. Peter Snell was another New Zealander who was. And Murray Hallberg, I think, had the record, world record, was 6 mile. He won some Olympic records. And Murray was disabled. Not really disabled, he was crippled. He had a gimpy arm. And so it was appropriate that he was involved in this kind of program. And he would organize a big dinner every year and also a tour around the country by a celebrity, and we'd try to bring a celebrity out. And one year we brought out Jesse Owens. I remember the negotiations. They called him in Chicago and talked with Owens directly, and he said he wanted, I can't remember the figures, but wanted $100,000 or something, and they hung up. They said, well, we can't afford that. And somebody on the foundation said, well, call him back and negotiate with him. I said, negotiate with Jesse Owens? He said, yeah, call him back and tell him what you can afford. So we called him back and we cited a much lower figure, and he took it. He said, I'll come out. He was a sight to behold. He too, if he walked into a room with 300 people, and we had a lot of receptions for him, a lot of cocktail parties, and we raised a lot of money for Jesse Owens, he would only have to walk into the room and the place would light up. You'd think that they had just thrown out a new bank of lights. He just shone. He was the most magnificent creature that most of us ever met. He truly was superior just in so many ways. It was wonderful to see him. The funny thing about him was that as we went with him, he went around the country and he would give speeches wherever we went. And he'd play golf. We had people paying money to play golf with him. It was a pretty good deal for the charity. He would give a speech, and he'd have people hanging on every word. He was a tremendously dramatic speaker, but he never said anything that made sense. He did not. He would start out with this phrase and then shift to another phrase and then another phrase, and none of it made sense, and none of it tied together. He would launch into things like, and never let it be forgotten that when in the world of blah, 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 your parents would never have believed, and he just went from one to the other, and people loved him, and they thought that he had really said something. And I used to think, well, maybe that was my imagination, but about 2-3 months ago, I was reading, I think it was a book review by a writer, and he spoke of Jesse Owens, or wrote about Jesse Owens, and he said the same thing. He said Jesse Owens had about 3 stock speeches, and none of them made any sense at all, and people just fell in love with him, and they thought, they went home thinking that he had really imparted something incredibly important to them. He hadn't said a damn thing.
He should have been in Washington.
Pardon me?
He should have been in Washington.
He should have been in Washington. But he was really just an astounding individual to behold and to be near. When I was a kid, back on the theme of seeing is believing, and I before I talk about when I was a kid, every year I speak to a bunch of young people. They come to Hartwick College, it's the next senior class kids, and we talk to them about leadership, and they ask me to come every year, and part of my talk is about the 4-minute mile, and I explain to them that when I was, I believe it was in high school, nobody really believed the 4-minute mile would be broken. It was one of those barriers that there wasn't much written about. It was just you know, it was like an 8-second 100-yard dash, you know. And suddenly, Roger Bannister broke that 4-minute mark. And he broke it with a team that had worked with him. One guy would run the first lap, another guy the second lap as a pacer, and they just worked very methodically as a team to break the 4-minute mile, and they did. I don't know how many months passed, but it was only a matter of months before John Landy in Australia broke it, because Bannister was in England. So suddenly we had two guys who had broken the 4-minute mile, and very shortly thereafter, everybody was breaking the 4-minute mile, and you weren't a respectable miler if you didn't break the 4-minute mile. And the point I make to the kids is, the other guys couldn't imagine it. It took somebody to break the record before the others could imagine. They didn't suddenly become faster. They didn't suddenly become better milers. They just could not picture it. Einstein said imagination is everything. And a lot of athletes have said that. And this was a wonderful example of this to the kids, that if you can imagine something, you have a chance of doing it. If you can't imagine it, you don't. And prior to Bannister breaking that mile, people just could not imagine breaking that. Right? One year, when I gave this talk afterward, one of the kids came up to me and said, there was a kid in his high school who was a high jumper. I think the figure was 6'2". He had jumped 6'2". He had done it for a couple of years, and that was his record. And he ended up jumping 6'4", but he didn't realize it. They had misset or mismeasured the apparatus, so they said to him afterward, you actually jumped 6'4". He said the kid was astounded. Never jumped 6'2" again in his lifetime, or 6'4". It blew his mind because he could not picture himself jumping 6'4", and in fact had done so. And it just shattered his illusions of himself. It ruined him as a high jumper, apparently. The guy who just broke the 100 meters, I can't remember his name, said after he broke it, I expected this. He could picture. He said, we've only just begun.
Yeah.
So he's got this in his mind. And Jack Nicklaus has talked about this. Nicklaus has said, you can't win the big tournament until you win it in your mind. You cannot win it until you can vividly feel yourself walking up the 18th fairway and the crowds, 30,000 people rising to your feet and the camera zeroing in on you. And you can imagine them slipping that green jacket, and you cannot win the tournament until you do that. Take a picture to feel it. So it's a picturing again. And it's an interesting thing to study.
Is that what you felt, Greg, when you won the Kappa last year?
Yeah.
When you were running from down the 18th? Yeah. He was a champion of the Kappa Classic.
We needed a 3-footer on the last goal. We knew the team behind us was one better than us, and we needed a 3-footer. And I don't know if we willed it in, but it went in.
He pictured it. You pictured it.
Somebody pictured it.
I read the break right. That's all I know.
I was watching TV one day years ago, and I think it was the Masters tournament. It may have been the U.S. Open. And somebody else might have a better recollection of it. There were three guys that were tied going into the last couple of holes. And the announcer said about one of them, he said, you may not have heard this guy's name or recognize his name, Ron Funceth. He said, Ron Funceth has had a few problems with valuation of himself, self-worth. That's an odd thing to say about a professional golfer. That's got to be pretty good. Peculiar thing to say. So, it turned out the three of them tied. So they had to go into sudden death. Played one or two holes. And one guy won. I can't remember who won. But I remember that Funceth did not win. So afterward, they interviewed the three of them in the clubhouse. And they stuck the microphone on the Funceth's nose and said, well, what did you feel like? He said, I didn't really feel like I belonged out there. He said, you know, I was surprised just to get in the final round. And he said, he lost it already. He couldn't picture himself winning. And they talked to the guy who won, who said immediately, he said, I really felt good out there today. Everything was dropping. I said, if I could do this and do that, I knew I had a chance to win. Totally different attitude. Funceth could picture himself as a champion. And wasn't a champion. I'm sure he had all the skills that the other golfers had. I remember when the New York Giants won the Super Bowl. I probably wasn't their first time there, but I can't even remember the year. But I remember all the hype And of course, being interviewed everywhere along the way, and they interviewed these guys as they came off the buses arriving at the stadium. And the other guys arrived first. I can't remember who the team was, but I remember the guys coming off the bus and said, what do you think? And most of them said, oh, well, we're going to do our best, we're going to give our best. And, and the Giants came off the bus, and I don't know what happened, but every Giant they interviewed said, I think we're going to do it. We really think this is our year. And it was a total difference in attitude. You wouldn't think you'd find that at that level. But the Giants obviously could picture what they were doing. They won the Super Bowl very easily. But to see the difference, and it reminded me of Joe Namath, everybody knows the great Joe Namath story. And he obviously could picture beating the Baltimore Colts. And he said so, and then some people say, oh, well, he was cocky and it was a boast. I think he just had that picture.
Yep.
And he could imagine. I have a good friend, New Zealander, lives in New York now. His name is John Wareham. And John's got a headhunting firm, international headhunting firm. I knew him when he was a very young man in New Zealand. We were both very young men. He moved from New Zealand to Australia. And that's where he really started going international with his firm. And Sydney, Australia has a magnificent harbor and a lot of sailing. There's a lot of competitive sailing. And John got into sailing. And he's a very competitive guy. And he wanted to be the best sailor in the harbor. Well, it took him a couple of years, and he got to be a pretty good sailor. He had a smaller size boat. And he decided to enter the Sydney to Hobart yacht race. It's a big, long race. Hobart is on Tasmania, which is an island south of Australia. And it's a perilous voyage some years. And hundreds and hundreds of yachts enter in all different classes, big, small. And he was in one of the, I don't know if it was the smallest class, it might have been, so small. And he just was all gung-ho for this race. They had trained pretty well. So off they went, got into the race, and a storm came, a very bad storm, and it really shook up an awful lot. It scattered the fleet all over the place. And anyway, he got down near Hobart, and he hove to, just took a little bit of shelter away from the storm. He lost his radio, lost some of his equipment in this storm. But he figured they were probably ahead of their class. They knew the big guys were already in Hobart, but he thought they'd be ahead of their class because they made a pretty good time. So he thought they could lay over there for a little bit. I think it was just getting dark. I don't know what the rules of the race were. He could have tried to get in that night, but he didn't. So there was a helicopter over him. They were filming him at one point. He thought, well, see, maybe we're in the lead for our class. But by the time they got to Hobart, next morning, there was his wife down on the dock, and there were lots of people down there, lots of cameras. He said, oh, this is good. And she said, you won your class? He said, I thought we did. Yeah. She said, why didn't you come in last night? He said, you mean when the helicopter came over? Yeah. She said, they were telecasting you. Why didn't you make the shot last night? He said, well, you know, you were ahead of everybody. You were ahead of all the big yachts. You would have won the entire race. And he writes about this in his book, and he said, the problem was, I didn't picture winning the big race.
Yeah.
I pictured winning my class. He said, it was all in perception. It was all in what I could imagine. I couldn't imagine beating those big yachts, but the storm had done so much damage, I could have won the big race. It was a matter of picture. And I had the same experience back when I was getting the money together for the Tom Morgan Company, because what happened is I formed a company, raised investors, we launched the radio program, we had a full television program. This was 22 years ago. And I went to see a guy, I went to see a lot of different people to try to find some investment. And finally did, and we formed the company, and gradually we bought out the investors. And they were happy, and we were happy. But along the way, I met a guy named Chester Davis. Chester Davis was Howard Hughes' lawyer. And if you read the biography of Chester Davis, or of Howard Hughes, you'll find Chester Davis very prominent. He was involved in the Summa Corporation, and there were a lot of scandals back then. Chester Davis was a very powerful financial figure. He has a summer home up in our area. And somebody said, why don't you go see Chester Davis? I said, well, I'll go see Chester Davis. Yeah. So I sat down with Chester Davis one night, and Chester basically said, well, listen, if you'd like to get, you know, maybe $20 million bucks behind this, we'll do it internationally. I couldn't fathom that. I couldn't imagine that. All I could imagine were relatively small numbers, small dollar figures. I could today, but I couldn't back then. And so I think he sensed that right away. And he was a very nice guy, and he said, you know, it's a piece of change to me to give you the kind of money that you want. I'm not going to get involved with it. I'll only get involved in multi-million dollar deals. And in fact, while we were talking, the phone rang, and he had to go into the other room. And there he was. I was seated before the fire, and he was on the phone saying, no, no, give him 50 million, maybe 70 million. I said, my God. But I couldn't think as large as he could. I couldn't picture. I couldn't imagine. And I was just like John Wareham in the little sailboat. I couldn't imagine one of the big number. So picturing this so down in the court, and we see it so much in sport. I remember talking to Dizzy Dean, changed the subject slightly. He used to go to some trade shows. He used to go to the National Hardware Show in Chicago. And he was just as much of a character as you ever saw him on television. He was just colorful. He used to plod down the aisle to go up to the hot dog vendor. He probably ate about 25 hot dogs in that. He was a great big guy. He'd talk with anybody. Talk. And everybody was partner that. And so I asked him if a certain anecdote was true. And he said, yeah, partner, it was true. And I said, well, which one of you guys did it? He said, it was me. I said, it wasn't that. He said, no, it was me who did it. And the anecdote was that they're playing ball one day, and they'd gone through about four innings, and it started to rain, and they were behind. And so they were dragging their feet because they wanted the rain to wipe out the game. And the umpire knew it, everybody knew it, and it was raining harder. And so anyways, time for him to go out the pitch, and the team's out there warming up, and there's no pitcher. And the umpire's looking around, there's no pitcher, there's no Dean. Finally, he goes over to that guy, he says, where the hell's Dean? He says, he's in the locker room. So the umpire sticks his head in the locker room and says, Dean, get out here and pitch. He says, I ain't going to pitch, it's raining too hard. He says, get out here and pitch, or you're out of the game, I'll throw you up. He says, I don't want to come out there, catch cold. So the umpire insisted, so out he comes. Got a raincoat on, galoshes, stopped out there with the money. Says, is that true, Dizzy? He said, that was true, partner. I'm going to shift to cricket. I'm talking about picturing things, and there's a picture that sticks in my mind now. It's a famous picture. Cricket's a lot like baseball. One of the differences is that while a guy's throwing the ball 100 miles an hour at the batter, who they call a batsman, the batsman is blocking the shots. He tries to make runs, but he's basically trying to block shots. He may be out there all day long. And there are three stumps in behind him. The sticks in the ground, and they got little wooden bales sitting on top. The bales are loose. So if the ball gets past the bat, crashes into those stumps, those bales go flying, and he's out. What causes him to be out is one of those bales fall into the ground. And the picture that sticks in my mind is of a guy named Brian Lara. He's a West Indian cricketer. He set the world record for the most number of runs ever scored in cricket. Tremendous accomplishment. It took him two whole days out there. Tremendous concentration. He scored 375 runs. Just astounding. For a high average for a cricket batsman is 40. And for a cricket batsman to get 100 runs is a big shattering event. That's really a momentous day for him. So here's a guy. Get 375 runs. He broke the old record, which was, I think, 340 or 350. He got to the point of breaking that record. All the cameras from the cricket world were on him, and everyone was holding their breath for him to break that record. The picture that is in the Hall of Fame in London of him breaking the record, there he is, swatting the ball and scoring the runs. And I was watching it. I was with the director of the museum. You know, that's a magnificent picture. It's a great big photo, and they've got a trophy, and then there's a tremendous thing for him. He said, you notice anything peculiar there? I said, no. He said, look at the bale. And there is a bale in the air. It's in the air. He said, now look at his foot. What had happened was that he had stepped backward, and in taking that record-breaking shot, his heel had pushed against the stump. And had that bale fallen on the ground, he would have been out. He went out on the very stroke where he broke this long-standing record. It's a record that would probably never be broken. But there was that bale in the air. If it had fallen, he would have been out. And I looked at that picture and I thought, that's the good Lord just telling this guy to remember that he is mortal after all. It was just
that's
the equivalent of Mark McGuire, you know, some little thing happening just when he broke the record. It was very interesting. Another picture sticks in my mind. Get to the Tigers. We got to go to see the Tigers once in a while. We lived in Bay City, Michigan, which was north of Detroit. My dad would take us down once a year to go watch. And then we lived outside of Detroit more, and we'd go into Detroit to watch once in a while. We got to go into a game one time, and Al Kaline was in his prime, and the Yankees were in town. And it was just a perfect day to go. We were high school kids, and it was perfect because Al Kaline had a tremendous arm, and it was just one of those games where he rifled a ball in from right field and nailed a guy trying to sneak home from third base. It was just phenomenal. Didn't even bounce, just went straight to the catcher on the line, out, and the whole place went crazy. So that was great for us kids, because Kaline was our superhero. We saw a triple play the same day. And then the greatest sight that sticks in my mind, we didn't have television, so we hadn't seen this before. Casey Stengel went out to the plate, and Yogi Berra went out to the mound, and Yogi Berra went out at the same time. You gotta imagine this. Casey Stengel's got hips out to here and his legs come in like baby roosters. And he's got his hands on his hips. I think he did this just to accentuate the whole thing. So he looks like a walking train. And Yogi Berra's got legs that go like this. And his arms go like that. And so you got one guy going out looking like a gorilla and the other one looking like a chicken. And they go out to the mound together. It was the funniest sight that I and I said, if I never see another baseball game, I will always remember that wonderful picture of those two guys going out to the mound. I was telling Greg, I had a friend in New Zealand who was a journalist, and he spent a year in the States, and he loved baseball, and he got to go finally to a baseball game where Casey Stengel was, and he got to go interview Stengel and talk with Stengel, because they told Stengel that he was a New Zealander, and Casey pretended he didn't know where New Zealand was. But anyway, he would talk to this fella, his name was Jack Kelleher. Jack said they went to Casey's press conference before the game. And Casey had all these Stengelisms and all this crazy language, which hardly anybody could understand. I guess the sports writers could after a while. But he'd answer a question and all this. And then he'd turn to Jack and he'd say, what I mean is so-and-so, so-and-so. And then he'd go back and give him more Stengelisms and say, what I mean is so-and-so. And Jack said, you know, I was probably the only guy that ever realized that Casey really spoke English as well as this other language. I don't know if you've ever seen that wonderful tape. I'd love to get a copy of it, of Casey Stengel and Mickey Mantle testifying before Congress. I can't remember what the issue was, but they asked Stengel a question, and Stengel talks for about 5 minutes, and you cannot understand what the hell he is talking about. He is all over the place, and everybody's laughing, and he finally finishes, and the chairman says, Mr. Mantle, what do you think about this question? And Mantle says, I agree with Casey. It's a wonderful bit of theater. Tigers. We love the Tigers. And that was a lot of those guys right from our era. I remember Trucks and Vic Wirtz and center fielder named Moon. And Kaline, of course. And Key and Kaline were phenomenal pair. Didn't have any pitching for years and years, not until Bunning came along and had some decent pitching. And that comes to what I wrote in column about, and that was that Tom Morgan came to play for the Tigers. And, you know, somebody with your name came to play for your favorite team, you'd probably be as elated as I was. There was a Tom Morgan who played for the Yankees, played for the Tigers, and there was one other team he played for, one or two. Anyway, I just joked around and thought this was magnificent, but we didn't have television, so I never got a picture of him. I never saw what he looked like. And I probably didn't even read the sports pages enough to, so I didn't know what he looked like. And I imagine he was a pretty handsome hulk, and, you know, a glamorous looking guy. That was my picture of him. We moved east again, and I think I followed him a little bit more then. Years and years passed, and I was an adult working, And I had to call on a client in Detroit. Flew out to Detroit, walked in the door, and the guy looked up from his desk and said, "Tom Morgan, ugliest son of a bitch ever played baseball." "What do you mean by that?" He said, "Well, he was. He was young." I said, "How could he be the ugly?" He said, "He was ugly." I don't believe it. He said, "He looked ugly. He talked ugly. He pitched ugly. And he walked ugly." I said, "How could a man walk ugly?" He said, "Well, they called him Plowboy because he came from Kentucky. And he always looked as though he was walking along behind a mule." He said, "He just kind of ka-thumped his way out to the mound." I said, "I never heard anybody walking ugly." Anyway, I told Greg Peterson this. And Greg said, "Did you ever see a baseball card of him?" I said, "No, I don't know if there ever was a baseball card of him." Greg found a baseball card.
He found
wonderful, thoughtful Greg. And he sent me that baseball card. It's encased in plastic. Sits in my office, and I have looked at that picture very carefully. And you know what that guy said, I mean, was absolutely true. I think he was ugly. In fact, I think he was major league ugly. And with that, I think I'll if got comments or questions or reminiscences.
You mentioned Al Kaline. My dresser drawer at home, I have my one and only baseball club that I bought in the 40s, Al Kaline.
Wow.
Did you know that we had a Greg Peterson on the team last year?
Did you really?
With the Tigers.
Right. With the Tigers.
Oh, I didn't have the, I like you, never had the privilege to even shake his hand.
Well, I think he stayed overnight.
I think so, but
I was here for one night.
Where is he playing for that?
No idea. It was a second round draft pick. You know how you look on the internet. That was the beauty of the internet. You saw who they got drafted. I said, "You got to be kidding me." Greg Peterson. And obviously, they'd seen my tapes from 30 years ago. So I was really looking forward to meeting Greg Peterson. It's a photo op, if nothing else.
Sure.
Right here in Jamestown, New York. So sure enough, he comes in. They called. Norma called and said, "Hey, Greg's in town." I said, "Great, I'll be down tomorrow." I called Jim Riggs, the sports guy. I said, "This is a story. Booster of the Jammers, and local, you know, whatever he was." I get down there that night. The manager told me, well, he blew out his arm the night before. The only night he was here, he blew out his arm, and he sent him home in the morning. So to this day, I don't know what Greg Peterson looked like.
You never saw him.
All right, I do have a program with his name in. That's the best.
I remember the summer that Wally Johnson played at the stadium. I got more phone calls from women. Thinking I was the baseball player.
Well, tell Tom the end of the story. What did Wally look like?
He was black.
Greg.
No way.
You were talking about Tom Morgan, the ball player, yeah, being ugly. A few years ago, I had the occasion here to go to the airport to pick up a player in the expo over here. And Bob Gebhardt was at the airport waiting to pick up the secretary coming in. And the flight we were waiting for, that they were both on, was delayed. So we had 2.5 hours to sit there and talk. And talking about different ball players. And he said that when old ball players get together, they always talk about the all ugly team. And he mentioned Tom Morgan.
I'm surprised.
And he also mentioned, some of them remember Earl Rapp, who played here in Jamestown. Yeah. And Earl Rapp currently runs a scouting organization for Major League Baseball, but he's another one that always, the name always comes up.
Now I'm glad to see you bored, all those people, they left early, you know. Here it is, 2 o'clock. Thank you. This is incredible.
Good to see you all.
Thank you for coming.